The following podcast is brought to you by the Jonas Podcasting Network, found exclusively at wrestlingwithjonas.com.
Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy. I am joined on this edition, because I don't know if I'm doing 2 a week or 1 a week, by the Beautiful Bruiser. We're here to sin with Molly Spartan. Welcome to the show.
Lovely intro, thanks for having me.
I'm well practiced at this point. So the first question is always the same, but I'll get to that in a second. Well, I'm going to change it. We changed the first question this time because you put out the I said before we recorded, the bat signal to get people to record and get on podcasts and to just contact you. Why? What put out the call? Why did you go, right, I need to get onto podcasts?
I have a genuine reason, right? So a lot of people come up and ask. There's weird, like I'll be at shows and things like that and people will sort of be like, oh, I'd love to see you in this podcast, or like, I'd love to have you on it. And I'm just like, okay. Which usually makes them go, what? And I go, okay. Like, when are you thinking? What time? Except like, we'll try and work it out. So I'd had that sort of stuff before in the past, but also I bought a new desk to go in this room and thought, well, if I'm now getting the desk and I'm going to have the place where I can have a laptop set up and etc., then I could go on podcasts and it's going to be a lot easier rather than that strange sort of like, the many times I've seen interviews and it's that weird sort of strange angle like, yeah, so I did this and then I was like, I could sit in a chair and like you could see me and I could move my arms and I'm all free and it's not just on my lap. So yeah, I thought like, okay, let's put the bat signal out there and see if anybody would remotely be interested in hearing my rabblings about wrestling and how I view things, because although in the ring, I have my methods, I have my dealings with my own business, and some people agree with it, and some people strongly disagree with how I go about things, but outside of that, we also have the things we're passionate about, the things we love, and the love of this business. And yeah, I thought maybe somebody might be interested in hearing my ramblings. And some might, even this ends, may have people be like, that's plenty off. But I hope not. I hope you stay around to hear the things that I'm going to say. And I hope it's at least remotely interesting. Or my poor, poor husband is going to have a very long marriage of me talking nonsense.
I think I half set this podcast up so my wife doesn't have to put up with my ramblings and what have you. Because, yeah, she likes to wrestle. She'll go to a rumble. She'll go to a show. But she doesn't particularly is interested in me doing a couple hour rundown of each part and each show and how great it was and why it was great.
Like she doesn't understand when you're just sort of like so-and-so returned, they've come for this, and she's like, okay, that's nice, dear. You
tell the other people.
You go tell the strangers in the camera. Go on, you go.
Yeah, the only one she was excited about was when I told her Edge was back, because she was like, oh, I remember Edge. I was like, yes, he's back. Will you watch it now?
Edge is my boy. That's my boy. Like, my poster boy. That was it. Oh, I was And Edge came back. Oh, like, I was just silent. And as you can tell, I'm not a silent person. it was great. I had a friend just grab me and was just like, oh my God. Well, she was like, that rumble, so I work for a company called Inside the Ropes as well, and that's who I usually watch the rumbles with. Obviously couldn't this year, but usually is with them, and we do a tombola, so we get numbers. We've got like a wee bingo machine and we pick numbers, and I had 16 and 21, so I had Drew and Edge. Oh. So I did really well that tombola. and won the men's one, and I was just, I was delighted I had Drew, and then when Edge came back, oh dear lord, I was like, I knew it, and we did like an online tombola this year, we couldn't be together, and I got Edge, so I won again with Edge the following year. The boy's lucky.
He's not bad, but were you on that tour with Inside the Ropes with Edge?
Yeah, I genuinely believe Kenny McIntosh booked Edge purely to see me be flustered. Like, it was a great tour, and of course you would want him, but like deep down, number one reason was I want to see Molly be absolutely flustered, not quite sure what to do with herself for a day. I remember our first date we did was in Belfast, right? Because I was thinking of the venue. It was in the Limelight in Belfast. And Fiona Loughran, she's basically our transport sort of coordinator. She deals with all the driving, she'll pick up the guests and bring them to the venue, etc. So normally, when I'm doing my job, if I see Fiona, I know the guests arrive. I'm like, right, cool, he's here. We need to make sure, etc., etc. Go up and introduce yourself and stuff like that. The thing is, so I'm doing my job and I turned around and he was just like there, like he wasn't far away from me, and I just had that moment, and I remember he had his back to me but Kenny was sort of in front of him, so Kenny can see me and I'm just like, I'm not ready, and just ran away. He never saw me, ran away. Kenny just ran away, and Kenny was like, oh, there she goes. And like, he was like, come and say hello. And like, eventually they had to like, come and say hello. And I'm like, hello, how you doing? And then the next day was in Dublin. And Edge adores this place called Offbeat Donuts. Like, when he was filming Vikings, he used to go and get them. So he loves these donuts. And he showed up with this giant box for us. And he had a wee box for himself, which he ate entirely to himself. When I say a box, I mean like six donuts. To himself, right? And we had this big box, but then all of a sudden I walked in and one of the donuts was missing, and I was like, who ate one of the donuts? He ate one of our donuts, and I tried to be like sassy and have attitude with him, but Fiona said it was the funniest thing she's ever seen, because I was trying to be like, oh aye, you steal one of our donuts, yeah? But my face was going, oh aye, steal one of our donuts. I just could not smile, and it took me like 2 days to like knock out and go, right, just act like a normal, just act like you, just be cool. But I wasn't, I'm usually very cool. Like, I can deal, like Shawn Michaels and none, I was cool, I was fine. Hello sir, how you doing, can I get you anything? That fine, didn't get flustered on an Edge, but he's my boy, man, he's my boy. But yeah, it was the best. And like to a point where now we follow each other on Twitter, so I was able to like send him a congrats message, and like I actually, after the Rumble, when he come back, I actually sent him a message saying, I had you in the tombola and you didn't win. And then went, you're lucky I had Drew though as well, so I won. And he was like, oh, that's great. But yeah, he's a lovely, I'm very happy so far that anybody that has made, that was significant in me loving wrestling so far have all been like lovely. Like, anyway, really important to me has been lovely, and it hasn't decimated the reason for me doing what I love. Because if any of them had been awful, then it would have broken my heart. And I'm like, there's no point to this. Why am I? But yeah, no, that didn't happen. So luckily, they've been cool.
I've got, like, when you say you were flustered, I had the same kind of feeling when I met Leah. And I, unfortunately, when I get flustered, I just open my mouth, let my belly rumble. So I've said in our podcast, but she complimented my t-shirt. I was wearing a Hardy Boys t-shirt because I didn't have a Leah one. And she went, oh, nice t-shirt. I went, oh, I couldn't find one of yours. So that was a good start. And then she went, oh, what's your name? I went, oh, just say my name. My name's Billy. I'm not going to sell it on eBay or anything. And I'm looking at her going, why am I saying this? These are words coming out. I don't want them to come out. They're gone. I'm so
that
sorry.
Happens a lot, though. That's not an unusual thing. Like, I think it's that way where, like, for me, they were desperate to see it because I and then said the ropes on, I am Mrs. Cool. Like, I can just be fine. Like, it doesn't, I constantly just go in going, they're just a person. Like, the last thing they want is somebody being like, ugh. But I think by the end of it, like, obviously, like, Kenny had told him, like, by the way, you're her favourite. Which he was like, I can kind of, like, the first couple of days, he was like, I can kind of tell, but she was trying to, I'm just being cool about it. I'm trying to be cool about it. But once I sort of relaxed in, he was like, oh, she's sound, like, she's not an absolute nutter. There was a point, though, I remember, like, we went and got them, like, gifts for sort of just being sound. So we got him, like, a bottle of whiskey, and we went and got his girls, like, there was, like, a story about a wee Midgie and Nessie, and we got, like, little... Like, one was, like, a healing cow toy and a wee Nessie toy, and, like, we got Beth a scarf and stuff. And we thought, like, that'll be nice, like, send him away, like, with some presents from us, because he's been lovely and he's went and bought us things, like, just out of the kindness of his heart, we'll do the same. And there was a point he just went, all right, and he went on his phone and he was chatting and he just went, yeah, this is the... And passed his phone, and it was Beth on the phone, and I was just like... You all right? Go Amazon, how you did? Like, I just was like, what the? Hello? She was lovely, and she was really, thank you so much for your scarf, like, I really appreciate it. The girls will love the print, like, and how, like, I was just like, that's a lovely couple. Like, they are well suited to each other. But the fact that even though he's age, and obviously for years people have shown up with gifts and presents and all sorts, the fact that he actually appreciates it, that, like, he didn't have to phone his wife to show her the presents that we'd got, you know what I mean? It was just like, and he did it while we were out the room. I'd walked in to, like, because it was in the venue, we had served food, so I'd walked in to ask him, like, hey, do you want food, like, do you want, what do you want? And he was just like, oh, there you go, here's Beth. I was like, oh, how you doing? Oh, cool. But yeah, like, yeah, he was lovely. And there's been loads, like, I've got some mad stories with some people, and a lot of people, some people I didn't expect to love, went away absolutely adoring, because they were just so, nice, and they were just so genuine. That's why I'm genuine, like, false pretenses, I'm just like, ugh, no thank you. But, like, genuine people you can connect with, and you can actually talk about things and ask them questions, and they don't get uppity.
That's the thing. I think the best interactions you have with wrestlers, I mean, I'm still, because I'm on the other side of the barrier, so I'm just, like, shocked anyone that agrees to speak to me in the first place. But when I meet wrestlers, I'm just like, the ones I remember are the ones that were just them. Like, I met Dennis Stamp. Didn't know who Dennis Stamp was, other than jumping on a trampoline. And mm-hmm. I spoke to him, and he spoke to me for a good 10 minutes about a story. And I was like, you're just happy to be here. And I'm happy that you decided to speak to me about it. Anyway, right. The first question is, how did you get into pro wrestling? So what got you hooked?
So, like, a lot of people that I know in sort of my age bracket was usually, like, a cousin or a brother that had a tape and they showed it to them and et cetera. And that didn't really happen for me. Like, most of my cousins were female. I had a couple of male cousins, but I never really had much to do with them. So I didn't really have that. And I was always, like, a tomboy. Like, I have a younger brother who's 5 years younger than me, but we used to always just, like, play football, climb trees and stuff like that. And I always had that sort of boisterous kind of side to me. But the one thing that I think it genuinely would be my mastermind, like, topic, if you were to actually ask me, would be on the Powerpuff Girls. At that age, loved, like, they were my idols, like, adored all the villains, him and Mojo Jojo and stuff like that. But that was obviously broadcast on Cartoon Network. And growing up, we used to have this small, like, it's like a black Tele West box. It had red digits. And the channel Cartoon Network was on at 9 o'clock. It would change to TNT, which famously hosted WCW. And I remember there was, like, my mum and dad would go out. It was either, like, a Friday or a Saturday. They'd go out to sort of the local sort of workman's club kind of thing. and my cousin would come round and sort of babysit me and my brother. And this Friday, I was sort of sitting watching The Powerpuff Girls, as I always would when it was on. And usually what would happen at 9 o'clock is this like screen would come up and it'd have like, for some reason I remember the logo rotating. I'm not 100% if that's true or if that's just something I've edited in my own mind, but it was this TNT logo rotating and it was saying like, the channel was about to change to TNT. This is past the watershed kind of ilk was on the screen. And this, for some reason, this 9 o'clock, usually the screen that would come up and I'd be like, okay, right, change the channel. No more Cartoon Network. Hadn't come up and the next episode started. So I was kind of like, oh, it's not changing. It's not changing. This is going to be... And pretty much at that moment when I was like, oh, it's not changing. The screen changed instantly to Bill Goldberg's face just screaming in the telly. Like, just being like, ah! And I was like, ah! And sort of fell off a kitchen table and was like, what is this? And at that point, my brother obviously was like, what's going on? And we sort of started watching wrestling because of that, because Bill Goldberg terrified me so much I fell off a table. Like, it was just great. And I remember, like, we'd watch it and we'd end up watching it in the living room. And my mum would usually, when my mum and dad came home, my mum had a weird theory where whoever got punched first was winning. Like, that was her theory in WWE. Whoever got hit first, be kick, punch, whatever, they won. The other person was the one that was losing, right? So she used to come home and then just sit and be like, they're winning, they're winning, they're winning. Stop it, right? But obviously, over years, it would have sort of evolved. And obviously, we started with WCW, but then obviously when we changed, like, cable providers or that, and ended up with Sky, that sort of way, and sort of WWF would come about, and that's when my brother would find his still fatuation with Dwayne The Rock Johnson. So much so that I remember when he was moving out for the first time, there was, like, a poster that was on the back of his door and had been there since he was, like, I don't know, three, that he got at, like, Kinross Sunday Market for £1. It was like that sort of, you know, remember those laminated posters? Like,
oh, yeah.
It was one of those of The Rock, and it was on the back of his door, and, like, when you removed it, like, there was a clear colour difference in the door. For years it'd been there. I had never moved, never budged. It was just on the back of this door. And so obviously that progressed of him being The Rock and I was Stone Cold Steve Austin. So he took many stunners and I took many rock bottoms and I managed to, even though he was tiny, like going for it. And we were always very rambunctious children. So wrestling was great. And like, obviously it progressed onto like my dad staying up to record WrestleMania or SummerSlam so you could watch it the next day kind of thing. So that's sort of how I got into wrestling as a fan. But I'm hoping that's what you meant as a fan.
Yeah, it was.
That's fine. I was like, do you want me to go on how I was a wrestler? Or like...
No, that's like my third question. But okay. there's always... For me, it was my friend's dad, but there's always a dad that had to stay up. And because either they didn't know how to set the record, the VHS... Or actually didn't know and didn't want to tell you, they didn't know how to, so they would stay up and just go, right, I'll go to bed then, and that's it. But I remember getting many a tape of WrestleMania. My mate's dad had to stay up twice because WrestleMania 17 was too long, so it went over a 3-hour tape. So he had to wait until the replay was on box office to tape the next bit. So.
My dad worked offshore for all my days and stuff. And there was a point when I can't remember. He still talks about this to the day how he was in an airport, basically Aberdeen Airport, before he got the helicopter out and stuff. And in the waiting room was Razor Ramon and The Undertaker. They must have been doing Aberdeen, and he was just like, there was these giant men, and then he realised, oh, and they were like, so what rig is it you work in? It was like, I don't I'm the Undertaker. But yeah, like my dad always talks about that, and there was somebody else, but I can't remember who it was, but always it would be Razor Rome and the Undertaker. But I still like to go, was that post WCW or like before it kind of thing? Like, I don't know how long ago it was, but yeah, he talks about meeting them both in Aberdeen. And I'm like, okay.
That's, yeah, that's such a, again, such a dad thing. It's just go, hi, how are you? Hi. I think I've met them. But you've actually met the Undertaker yourself as well now. So it's running in the family.
I didn't confirm it with them. I didn't go like, here, Mark, did you meet my dad in 91? Like, but yeah, like just, but no, I like 100% believe that my dad did meet them. Like, that's just, my dad's that kind of, my dad once had like, my dad told a story about how, so he used to get the train from Aberdeen to Kirkcaldy after he'd get off shore. He said he was on a train and this guy, and he was with like a few workmates with some beers on a table, and this guy, this body appeared and was like, hey, can I join you for some drinks? I want a drink, but I don't want to drink alone. And they were like, yeah, sure. It was Lemmy from Waterhead. I was like, can I join you? And they were like, sure, mate. Like, of course you can. And half the boys didn't know it. And this was like just when he'd appeared on The Young Ones, or so, it was something like they'd just been on like a show. So you like sort of like they were back at like the height kind of thing. And there was like a buzz about them. And he was on this train. And it must have been like an Aberdeen to London train or something. But yeah, this just cowboy hat, everything, like Lemmy, like was Lemmy all the time. I was just like, here, can I share a drink? But he talks about that. And there was the time he met Richard Hammond, but was convinced he worked on an oil rig and kept sort of asking, like, what oil rig is you work on? What? No, but where about? Like, is it this? And he had to go, no, I'm on the telly. He'd be like, the telly? What are you on? And he was like, Top Gear. And it was that moment, he was like, oh, no, okay, I know who you are. But that was my dad. My dad's got all those stories about how the time he was sitting on a bench and then to his left was, oh, it was him. And you're like, okay, Dad, sure. You've got hundreds of them.
My only comparative story is my dad used to work at a hospital up in Elgin, because that's where I am. And Fred McCauley was there for some reason, opening something, I don't know. And he went up to him and went, oh, how you doing? I'm Fred. And my dad didn't know who he was. So he went, good for you. And walked off. And I saw him on the telly. I was like, oh, I met him. Still don't know who he is. But yeah, that's my favourite of, he's just so nonplussed about things. And I mean, I wouldn't know who he was, but I'd be like, oh, that's quite cool of him. Anyway, right. So you went, how did you go from that to WrestleShark then?
Oh, that was just because, so I was working for ICW at the time and met Simon and DCT and just became friends with them. I basically ended up when it used to be OWS, when it was the one wrestling show beforehand on Pulse. I used to be part of that, but I ended up coming in when they did a 24-hour like charity show where we were up for 24 hours. And I said, look, well, I'll come in and help out. Like, I'll be your extra hand. So when yous are all, because at the point it was just down to them that were on the show. And I was like, you can't, like, you need to eat at some point, and you need to have somebody that's going to help you with that, that's going to make sure. So like, we had a local Domino's just send us pizzas for free because we were doing it for charity, which was lovely. And like, I made soup and things like that. Like, just sort of went, I'll be the extra pair of hands that help you with that. But I also knew how to run the radio desk because I'd done sort of like a course in radio, and then I've got a Bachelor of Honours degree in television. So I learned all sort of that side of things. So when I walked in, I was like, oh, I know how to work that. And they were like, what? I was like, I know how to work that. Like, I actually know how to work that. To a point where I was showing them things they didn't know. I was like, well, if you hold that button and slide that down, this is what happens. And they're like, oh, okay. But it was that way where I was able, when I walked in, I was like, I can run that desk. And they were like, oh, so it meant that, like, if somebody just wanted to just have a sit on the floor for like half an hour through a 24-hour broadcast, they could. So that's kind of how I ended up there. And then it became the big WrestleSharp show when Simon and DCT sort of came in and sort of it sort of changed, obviously, presenters a bit because of their commitments and stuff that other people had. So yeah, that's how I sort of ended up there. I was the person that would do the weekly round off of, I had to convey Raw in a minute or something. Like I had like a time on the clock. So I had to like watch all of Raw and then write it in notes. Like, how am I going to say all this in, it was like 1 or 2 minutes. Because they were like, we don't want to talk about it the whole show because it was on a Tuesday. So tell me what happened in a couple of minutes. And I'd be like, okay. So I used to have to do that. But I also was able to run the desk. So that's how I ended up involved because I was able to go. And knew how to do that. And knew how to use that particular desk with no trouble. But I also liked the fact that it was... there was a female voice, because at the time there was hardly any female voices in the world of like wrestling broadcasting. Like even at that point, I think when I first started, I don't think even Renee Young had started, or she'd just come in the door. So even she was new, if that makes sense, to have someone who was opinionated in a topic that wasn't just being, yeah, that was actually knowledgeable in what they were talking about, so nobody could argue to the fact of why I was there, if that makes sense.
Yeah, so you're actually there, you had an opinion. I mean, by women, I suppose, at what we're talking about, 2012 or whatever, but we were still like, they were the valets, or they were the one with the microphone holding it, but not actually allowed to have an opinion themselves. And that's why I was like, that's why I like listening to WrestleShark. I mean, obviously there's plenty of banter. And I started watching wrestling, Scottish wrestling anyway, in 2012. So this is how I was kind of finding out about more that's about, because I did stuff about SWA and ICW and all that kind of thing as well. Mm-hmm. And it was great to hear like your voice, because like, oh, there's a female involved. Great, that's fine. There's a different spin on things. Because like I say, there wasn't that many voices. And even now you still get, if you're a female fan, oh, you like wrestling, name every WWF champion from whatever to now. And it's just, I couldn't do that.
The thing is, if anybody ever does that to me, I go, okay, go.
Yeah, exactly.
And I go, you name them. Why do I need to get tested here? How about we test you instead? Don't give me that chat. Like, enough. I've been that, like, when it wasn't, like, obviously, like, I've come around when, like, the Scottish wrestling boom has come about, but I remember there being, like, times where I'd go to places just to watch wrestling in, like, a bar, and sometimes I'd be, like, the only female in the room, and it was odd. Now it's not that. Now there are women at the shows, which are great to see, in that they feel comfortable coming out to shows. It's not as... male, or it still is obviously quite a male orientated thing because it's bravado and etc., but is more a welcomed female environment now than what it used to be. But yeah, like I was on the show because I did have a valid opinion. It wasn't just because we have a girl, it was because, well, if anything, the girl runs the show. Like she was the ones that press the buttons to make it work. And I was able to obviously have a valid opinion that wasn't just a case of, oh, they've got a girl. It was, oh, no, she knows what she's talking about. So, yeah, of course she's on the show. She can talk, and she talks about, like, it's not just nonsense. It's not just like, well, their gear was really nice. I am very particular on people's gear. But that's just because I'm very particular for myself. But yeah, it wasn't just that. It was very much a case of, like, it's not you come on and talk about the girly things. And I'm like, there's no, that's nonsense. I'll talk about that match and what was the psychology of this and stuff like that. And yeah, the guys were always, it was never a case of she's the girl. It was a case of, okay, Louise is here.
So was broadcasting always something you wanted to do then? You said you got a qualification in that kind of thing, that kind of area. So is that something you'd always wanted to do?
Yeah, it sort of all works into like how I became a wrestler as well. Because originally at the time when I was watching wrestling at that point, it's a weird sort of thing where originally when I started in production. For a long time watching it, I never related to any like the female talent that was on screen. So it wasn't that I wasn't confident and happy with who I was. I just thought at that time, watching what I was watching, there wasn't anybody that represented me. There wasn't anybody that was my size or my stature or even had my voice. Nobody had an accent like mine either. So I never felt like I would be welcomed. You know what I mean? I felt like if I tried to go down that path, I wouldn't be allowed to be part of it as I wasn't meant to fit in, kind of thing. So I never thought that I would ever see myself as being the wrestler. But I always knew I wanted to work in wrestling. I wanted to be part of that world. So instead I would look at like WWE's website, see what jobs were going and sort of what qualifications they were after, and that's what I followed. That's what I went for. I went for what they were looking for and thought, right, well, if I study that, then at least that's the first step in the door. And in doing all that, I ended up meeting Billy Kirkwood because I did a project on the Stand Comedy Club, and he was the comedian that I would follow. And so I talked to the most. And after sort of following him, it was weird. Like, I remember like meeting him and like we met in a pub and then both discovered we were straight edge, so didn't drink any alcohol. We all both obviously have hunters of hair because it's just always there. I remember he walked in and I had like a Punisher hoodie on. And he had like a Punisher man, but it was really weird our first meeting. I was like, are you the male me? Like, this is bizarre. And then sort of just chatting away and things like that. And then I remember we did the project, but it always bothered me. He has like a Pepsi Cola tattoo on the inside of his arm, right? So obviously in my head, I'm like, does he just like Pepsi Cola or does he like CM Punk? But at the same time, I was like, you can't even ask that, because if you ask that question and he thinks, who is this nutter that, like, all right, cool. And I remember it was after the project was done, because I thought, no, don't do it now while the project... Weirdly, at that point, I only had, like, a small group of friends that even watched wrestling that I could talk to. I didn't have the vast amount of friends that I have now that watch wrestling that I could talk to. And I sort of... Like, I weighed and weighed, and then I remember, like, where we go, like, oh, here's some of the finished project, and saying it's up, and I went, can I ask you a question that's either going to make a lot of sense or none at all? I was like, do you just really like Pepsi Cola, or are you a big CM Punk fan? And he was like, well, yeah, I do like Pepsi Cola. How do you know who CM Punk is? And I was like, oh, wait, you know who CM Punk is? And so we discovered we both were really into wrestling and really liked wrestling. So sort of just built a friendship kind of thing from that. And he messaged me saying, like, you need to come see this. I've just got this gig with a company called ICW. They're basically Glaswegian ECW. It's a bit mental. I think you'll love it. And, like, I remember him talking about the one wrestling show. He was on the one wrestling show at the time. And he did this, no talking about it. And I remember sort of chatting to him, and he was like, right, your name's on the door, like, come and see this. And I dragged the mate of mine who'd never been at a wrestling show before. But I was like, come on, it'll be fun. And it was mental. Like, it was when they were doing their first ever, like, My Channel pilot. When they were trying to do that way, going doing like the back channels of Sky, and look at where they are now, like things have changed. But at that time, that was a big deal, and like that was like the infamous street fight where the second last match of this pilot, the ring just collapsed, like it properly was broken, like it wasn't getting fixed. And then the street match, and it went out in the streets, and somebody got thrown into a bus, and like a riot van ended up appearing at the end, like after the show was done, because they thought it was the year of the London riots. and they thought the Glasgow riot was starting. There were six men in Lycra and a bunch of people going, I see Tob. Why they thought it was a London, the riot starting, I don't know, but people panicked and phoned the police. And but it was great, like it was just mental, and I was just like, I need to work here. And I was like, the time, it was getting a point where I was going to need to look for like a work placement. I was going to need to find some place that I could sort of have credits from, let's say, to take for my degree. And I was like, I'm going to make this it. So I ended up meeting Dallas and basically said to him, look, I can get you a camera. Like, I've got insurance taken out at my uni. I can get you a camera, I can get you microphones, I can get you lights and stuff to save you having to constantly hire these ones. I was like, I can get you for nothing for a couple of years. All I'm asking is when I come to you with a bit of paper at the end of each year, you just sign it and say, yes, you did this. I went, it will be facts. It will be what I'm going to do. I went, but I just need you to be like, yes. And like, I'll write a thing and you just sign it. And he was like, cool, no bother, mate. That sounds great, right? And obviously at that point, like, that's really when they just went into like Classic Grand and they really just left Mary Hill, and they'd go back a couple of times, but it was sort of the moving up from like Classic Grand day, and it moved into obviously the garage and stuff like that in Glasgow. So yeah, that's kind of what I did for ages. Like that sort of, it sort of had this production side of things and had these qualifications. The only thing is once I left uni, I never left. I ended up staying there for ages, and then I ended up sort of training within that. But yeah, that sort of helped with the sort of the qualifications ended up becoming a thing, but it basically became a wrestling degree.
Yeah, that's what it sounds like. It's like you've took the most logical approach to get into the wrestling business to make it your life. And of course, then you did the backstage interviews. What was that like being in front of camera instead of doing the radio or things like that? What was that like for you?
See, that was fine. I've never sort of been camera shy. I was always like, as a kid, I was always trying to just sing and dance. Even though I was boisterous, I was always just sort of like I always like to, like, I love going to Butlins so I can just dance all night and have a wee sing and things like that. I always sort of enjoy, that was the most sort of girly aspect of me, is that I love a dance. But yes, I was never like camera shy. I was just trying to find the right approach. But obviously when I wasn't on for the camera, I ended up that I was behind the camera. I was doing a lot of the sort of the backstage sort of directing of the promos and getting people to find their voice and stuff like that, which is why I don't have any problem with mine. Or any fears in that department, because let's be honest, if the person who spent nearly a decade getting people to talk couldn't talk herself, something's wrong. But yeah, it was sort of that way. So like, I had no qualms going in front of the camera, and to be honest, like, even when we'd be wrestling as kids, I usually pretend to be that person too, like, oh, how did your match go? And like, even though it was just nonsense, but yeah, I had no issue doing that. But obviously I ended up with my crew, which was the lovely Veronica Lestrange and Jennifer Louise, who are two of my absolute best friends in the world. Love the pair of them still. And yeah, we were this little group of girls that were like, come talk to us now. But yeah, no, I had absolutely no qualms doing that, going in front of the camera. In fact, let me show off some lovely dresses I had.
So you went from that, doing all that behind the camera, in front of the camera, and then you joined GPWA. Were you in the first batch of trainees?
I am technically student number one. I am the prototype. Yeah, no, there's like, this is sort of where it becomes like a weird rom, it could be like a weird rom-com. But at the time, I remember it was in an Edinburgh show, and I'm like, it's weird, you know, just there's certain moments in time that like vividly stick in your head. This was one of them. And it was like before before there was any romantic interest at all. We were just work colleagues at the time. But Wolfgang, who is now my husband, We were literally passing beams. It was in Studio 24 in Edinburgh. And like the way that went out from the venue was there was this wee back door and it would go like diagonally. Like it'd go from literally the door going out, there was a corridor and then there was the fire escape. So we'd pass the beams out diagonally and it was absolutely teeming it down outside. Like it was just lashing. I remember like it was me and Wolfgang and we were passing these beams to the van. And like, so I'd pass it from there to him. He'd pass it to the next guy, put it in the van. And he was just chatting to me. He genuinely was just talking to me about how he'd always wanted, basically how he's seen his next step in Scottish wrestling was to coach. And he really had this sort of idea I had in mind on how he'd like sort of wrestling coaching to happen. And obviously at the time there was, in Glasgow in particular, there was the two major schools, which was PBW and Source. And at that time, like it was two sort of friends of his that were running the schools and he didn't want to upset one or the other by going to the other. But also at the same time, he didn't want to just follow someone else's sort of, he didn't want to come in and be like, this should all change when it's not his school. You know what I mean? So he had this sort of idea that he wanted. So he was talking to me about it and he was talking about how like, he wanted to sort of coach and he had his own ideas and he sort of had an idea of like who would be his other coaches and how they would go about it. And he just had this idea in his head. So as a mate at the time, I sort of said to him, right, okay, I'll be student number one. And at that point, I didn't think myself as I'm going to be a wrestler. I thought, I'll learn a different perspective. The only thing I didn't know at the time was what happened between the ropes, like what happened inside the ropes. I knew everything that happened on outside, where the camera's going, how it was cabled up, like how the door, what times, everything outside, but I didn't know anything inside. And I thought, if I do this, and it was like an 8-week induction course, I could learn a different perspective, I could apply it to what I want to do going forward, and hopefully that will make my filming technique better, or it make that, you know what I mean, that kind of, that sort of feeling towards it, so I can understand if the guys are coming back and saying, well I just did this and this, I could go, right, okay, well we'll do that. But it was a weird sort of thing, like after that sort of, like a year later after that conversation, GPWA was born, which of course was Wolfgang, BT Gunn, Red Lightning, Jack Jester, and the God rest his soul, Lionheart, started up the school. And I remember doing the 8 weeks, and at the end they would sit you down. And the way that GPWA works as a school is you initially do like an 8-week induction course, and they basically see sort of like what your capabilities are, like in a physical manner and like a psychological manner and everything like that, and if this is for you. And if for it, so like, it's really strange. One of the things a lot of people ask me is a lot of people come up to me and talk to me about how like, oh, I'd love to be a wrestler. I'd love to be, I just don't think I could. And the one question I ask them, and it honestly tells me a lot, is can you do a forward roll? If you can do a forward roll, you have more hope than you think, because it's such an important vital thing that a lot of people assume they can do because they did them when they were kids, but aren't able to do it now. And it can happen for many reasons. And it's not just me saying that thinking it's just giant guys that can't do them. Like there's giant guys that can do them with no problem, like just constantly do looks. And then there's skinny guys that just can't do it. But it's such an important role in order to keep things safe and to keep, you know what I mean, like yourself safe as well, that if you're unable to do that sort of thing, this isn't really for you, or you need to go address things, maybe something that's physical or health, a health choice, till you're able to do that kind of thing. That, the forward roll is just an example of something that, and for some reason that is a thing. Like there's a lot of people that come in and as soon as you go, do a forward roll, you just can't. Like there's been boys that have done it and for some reason went swiftly to the thing and like ran their head into walls and everything. Like it's just like, you're like, oh, what happened there? But it is, it's not an uncommon issue to arise, but it is something that needs addressed if it is an issue, because it's not just, as wrestling is, it's not just a one-person game. There's three to tango in total, if you think about the ref as well as if the match is even bigger. So that's how they do it. So they sort of do an induction, an 8-week induction to a certain point, and you're able to do this, then you move on to the second class, and then you sort of start getting a bit more advanced with things. And then once you get to that point, you move into the third sort of main class, and that's when you start sort of doing a lot more advanced stuff, a lot more intense sort of drills and things like that to properly prepare you for eventually either finding who you are as a performer, who you are as a talent, and sort of what you're going to sort of convey when you're out there performing, like what style suits you best, et cetera, et cetera. That's sort of when you come into the main class. And for me, that's the perfect way for me to be coached. And I'm not saying any other school is doing it wrong or they're doing it, but they are doing it differently. But for me, GPW was the perfect way to go in. I like this sort of like intense sort of looking how things are and the honesty that was there. So after sort of my 8 weeks, they would sort of sit you down. They would either discuss if you're moving on to the next class or what you need to go about or what they think you need to do in order to get yourself to there. If you really want to do it, this is what you need to do in order to get there. And I'll always remember this. It was Adrian himself, Lionheart, sitting there and saying to me, and I quote, "I'm going to be honest, mate, I thought you were going to be shit." I was like, thanks. Anyway, but you weren't. You weren't the best, but you also weren't terrible. You could do this. And sort of from there going, I could do this. And it was that weird sort of notion at the time was sort of like when like Piper Niven, Viper, however you know her, was sort of dominating and just killing it in Japan. And she was completely doing it in the comfort of her own skin. She was so confident in it. Like, she's beautiful how much confidence oozes out of this girl. And she's absolutely killing it in NXT UK as well right now. But it's that way where it was weird sort of finding myself in the place that I always wanted to be, but because of what was portrayed to me for years, just thought I wasn't wanted and I wasn't like, I was never to fit in that world. And for eventually to find it and go, oh, wait, I could do this. And I could do it being me. I can do it being the shape, the size and shape I am. I can do it with the accent that I have. I can travel around the world doing this and people will want to see me as long as I put the graft in, as long as I work hard and I do what is needed, then I could do this. And yeah, that's sort of how I became a wrestler. And I've never sort of looked back from thinking I was just going to learn it from a different perspective to actually doing it as my job is mad. And I've never been more confident in what I'm doing for work than I have now. I was always good at my other jobs, but they were always just jobs, if that makes sense. Like, they were always just jobs into the next job, into the next job, where this is something that I think about constantly. I'm constantly looking for like, oh, I could buy that jacket because that'd be good for this, or I can do, like, it's always on my mind. And I think that's, and I'm always wanting to get better, like constantly striving to be better and yeah, be irreplaceable when I go to places, if that makes sense.
I mean, passion always will override ability for a lot of people. For myself watching, it could be a match where nothing happens, but if I see that the wrestlers want it, or at least putting everything they are into it, then I'll remember that match more than I will remember a 20-minute everything happened kind of match, because to just go through the motions as well.
Like, storytelling is completely key. Like, I think one of my, it was Valentine's Day, that match between Pete Dunne and Finn Balor was incredible, and it was the psychology of it. It wasn't full of falsies, and it wasn't just pin after pin after pin of some big thing or that. Like, there was a genuine point where you're just going, I actually don't know how this is going, which is, that's key. And I feel like both Finn is great at that, but Pete is the master of it. Like, watching them, like I've actively said to folk, I was like, I could have an hour match with Pete, and for 45 minutes he would work my arm. You know what I mean? It's that kind of thing that, you know, he's got such great psychology. When you break his matches down, it's incredible. Like, it's nothing, but it's everything at the same time. And he's just, he's very good, that Pete Dunne. He's very, very good.
It's not bad. But yeah, speaking of that match, because lockdown's happening, I'm able to stay up and watch these shows now and not fear about having to look presentable for work. This is my office now, for the time being. But that match itself was, it was all built upon how Pete works an arm, a limb, a finger. And so when it was coming towards the end, when he thought, oh, Finn Balor's got this, as soon as Pete grabs the hand or wrist, and you saw the fear in Finn's face, I was like, oh, this is gone.
So I don't know if it ever got broadcast. I'm hoping it did, but I remember being at Download, and it was Pete Dunne versus Ciampa, right? It was like the main event in one of the Download shows, right? And obviously Pete was the UK champ at that point. And genuinely there was a point where I thought, oh my God, they're going to change the title. At a festival in the middle of a field in Donington. They were so, it was so good and so captivating that there was like squeaky bum time where I was like, oh my God, they might give this to chat. What the? Nah! Like, it was so good. And I always remember that going, they made me believe that something might be happening. Like a person that studies everything, believe that they could change the title here, which was just great storytelling, because obviously like people have that perception, and I, like, it's the sort of thing where I have a discussion with like AEW Dark, right? It's the prime example. I watch it every week. I still watch it because I watch everything, but it's very predictable, and sometimes it gets a bit boring when I see like one of the main roster on it, because I'm like, well, they're winning. Are they winning? Are they, you know what I mean? Like, when you get something that's might be more sort of the more unknowns and not the main cast, that's when I get excited, when I see those matches, because I'm like, I actually am not sure how that's going to go out. That could go either way. They're the matches I get excited for. But it wasn't like, so you assume that when you go to Donington and you're in the, there's the sort of, and unless they're getting recorded kind of thing for NXT UK, you sort of assume that you know the outcome, you know what's happening, you know, especially when there's a title on the line, you kind of have that assumption of like, well, I know how this is going. But for to make that 10 actually think for a moment, this might change hands, was just, mwah, 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 mwah. It was beautiful.
The example that I have in my head is, it's very much on the lower end of the scale, but I was at Aberdeen. Again, shouldn't have a title change in WWE at an Aberdeen show. Never going to happen. But for some reason, I was watching, I think it was, I want to say it was Mickie James against Beth Phoenix, because the two, I think it was them. And they had like the nearest of near falls. I think Beth is the champion at the time. And I was just like, oh my God, they've actually changed the title at Aberdeen. Why? How? Why? I was like so excited about it. And then, of course, it was like, oh, two count. No. But,
No, it wasn't.
No. Beth Phoenix won. Damn it. But, wrestling's just... Yeah, I always think that wrestling's best when you switch off and enjoy it. Like yourself. You might be studying it in the back of your mind, but at the front, you're just going, I just want to watch some wrestling. I'm enjoying what I'm seeing. Oh, my God. This could change at any time. And, like, you have that...
It's one of those things where... You could probably talk to wrestlers and so one of the things that annoys me is when I hear wrestlers calling wrestling fans marks, because to me, we're the biggest marks of them all, because we went and learned how to do it. We're actually putting our bodies on the line because we enjoy a telly show so much that we went, I'm doing that. Like, we're the biggest marks out of all of us. So if they hear anybody, I'm like, shut up. But it's that way where I love going to watch wrestling, but like, see, when I go away to like see watch Mania or a Takeover, things like that, like, although I love going with some wrestling friends of mine, I like going with my friends who aren't wrestlers because they're not, they've not got the same brain. Like, they go to enjoy it. So I'm able to just sort of go, right, I'm just watching wrestling. And there's times where I've gone in with wrestling friends and went, right, right, we're no wrestlers tonight. Let's just enjoy this. Let's not look too much into how that made this and did they try that. And no, stop it. Right? We need to think of it. And like, I've actually had friends who are not wrestlers sometimes say to me going, did they do that because of this? And I'll go, yeah. Like, they'll get that wee bit. And I'll be like, yay, that's great. We're there. Like, but it's that way where I do, like, the Inside the Ropes crew are predominantly my crew to go watch wrestling with. And when I go to Mania or I go to, like, a takeover and stuff, I'll go, like, even the last proper takeover in Blackpool, there's, like, videos of, like, that Kenny did of me where it was when the double senton happened off the ladder onto my husband,
yep,
who was on a table. Or was he on... Oh, he was on a table. Or was he on a ladder? He was on something, right? And he went off, and there's me taking off the engagement ring going, well, that's me single again, take that, hating on. And it was just us having a laugh, even though it was my soon-to-be, at that point, soon-to-be husband, who was being a, I was just like, nope. But like, it was also like learning things about, so like, the beauty of him being there is you sort of learn new things. So did you know that a rule in tag wrestling is you're only allowed, legally, you're allowed one breakup per team, right? Which a lot of people don't realise is a thing, but it is. Like, legally, one team is allowed to make a breakup, and then you're not allowed to do it anymore. So there was like a point, I remember there being a point in that match of me going, where's Imperium? Where's Imperium? And them going, why are you looking for Imperium? I was like, they've got a breakup. Vets have had theirs. Flash and Andrews have had theirs. Gals have had theirs. Where's Imperium? And at that point, I just remember seeing like Fabian Aichner's bald head appear from the other side of the ring. And I was like, there we are, there we are. Like, so that's like a thing that I've like, weirdly, like the wrestler brain in me goes, no, you're only allowed one breakup each. So like explaining it to my mates, they were like, oh, I didn't know that. I didn't realise I was like, that's a thing. So now it's a thing you'll watch, especially multi-man like tag matches, you're going to watch and go, oh yeah, one, two, you know what I mean? You're going to notice that now because that's a rule. So yeah, like I'll bring out wrestler brain sometimes to them and they'll go, oh, right, okay. But it allows me to detach myself from it because I do at the end of the day, I do love wrestling and I enjoy it. And if something cool happens, I love running in and being like, look at this, watch this again, play, rewind. Look at that, like... Yeah, me and Casey are the worst for it. Like, we'll send each other stuff all the time. Like, look at this. This is cool. What about this? Did you see this? No. Like, she can detach herself. Like, our first Mania was 33 when the Hardy Boys came back. And that was, like, they're her fave. Like, she instantly just starts crying. There's this absolute screamer of a photo of the pair of us. And I'm just like... And she's just like, ah! And she lost it, and I was just like, yes, okay, we can do this. And even like BT Gunn, it's his favourite too, he was going, we were all going mental, and it was that moment where I was like, right, we're all fans, like we've stopped being there, we're all fans now. And it was just, it's so much fun when you can just go, no, there's a reason we started doing this, it's because we think it's great, so let's enjoy it.
There was a lot to unpack in that I had thoughts on. The bit about tag team wrestling, yes, I was somehow in Krieger's lesson about tag team wrestling in Looking Sharp's online dojo. And then the very next day I watched a tag match, AMW against the Clive Crew. I was like, oh, that's what Krieger said. Oh, they're doing that. Oh, they're doing this. I'm like, my God, there's a new layer of things that I never knew after 20 years of watching wrestling.
Yeah.
That Marks thing, I'm sure I heard it on WrestleShark, and it's always stuck in my head because, I mean, it holds more weight with yourself, an actual wrestler saying it. But for me going, but wrestlers are the biggest marks. They're doing it.
It's
so.
Like, it's a thing I've said for years. Like, who are you? I remember actually Adrian, I think, once tweeted it out, and he messaged me going, is it cool if I write this? Because you're right. And I was like, yeah, yeah, go ahead, mate. And he tweeted about it. But it was something I've said for years. So I was like, what are we talking about? Like, I went on a WWE website, looked up what job qualifications they were, and then spent my years in university. You know what I mean? Like, I am the biggest mark that is going. It's not a bad thing. Like, there's a difference. Like, I think what they mean is people that are, like, annoying and invasive. That's got nothing to do with a fandom of wrestling. People are annoying and invasive. That's because they're annoying and invasive. They're just annoying and invasive to wrestlers. It's got nothing, like, they could put that energy in, like, Game of Thrones actors or whatever. There's people exactly the same, but just a different topic everywhere. But, like, just treating everybody the same, I'm like, no, everybody's different. And being a mark isn't a bad thing. Like, sometimes it gets you far.
Sometimes you're main event in WrestleMania. That's just how life goes. Right, so we're back into the wrestling a little bit. We talked about your training, talked about how you got there, your first match. I did have it written down. I don't have it written down. It was against Casey, wasn't it? Am I right in thinking that?
My first wrestling outing was at a gala day, which was in a battle royale, which obviously at the time was just my coach, but Wolfgang gorilla pressed me out of ring. I scraped my shin, and it was literally a wee scrape off the edge, and I ended up getting a staph infection in it, so I had a scar on my leg, which I jokingly said, like, you were leaving your mark on me all those years ago. Like, you're like, that one's mine. But that was my first wrestling outing, which there's photos of me in it, and I've got this mad, colourful gear with, like nothing like I am now, but it was one of those cases of just, like, right, so we've got this, you're going to be in it, get something to wear. Okay. But my first proper match where, I was able to properly, like, think about it and worry about it, because we all do on our first one, was actually a tag match, and it was myself and Carmel Jacobs against the Owens twins. And it was great, and... yeah, that was my first one. It was great to be in a ring with those girls who I'd worked with and got to be friends with as well. So they were kind of like, it's okay, it's going to be fine. And I'm like, okay. And my first singles match was with Casey as well. So yeah, I've had my gala day out, and my first match was a tag match, and then my first singles match was with Casey. So Casey's been with me the whole time. I just kind of get rid of her. Like, I try and lose her in the forest sometimes, but she finds me again.
So you did say that everyone was kind of around you just saying it'll be fine, but what were your initial thoughts going into your first couple outings, even tag team singles? What was your first, like, a reaction with getting everyone involved, actually doing the moves, make sure everyone's safe? There's a lot to think about. So how was it?
Like, I pride myself in being... safe. Like, I've never had any major injuries or problems happen in the match. I've never done anything like that. So that I'm kind of proud. I've got, like, a weird thing where I sort of, like, have this weird ritual in my head where if I don't do it, somebody's going to die. But it's not true, but I have it in my head. But yeah, like, on my first, I just remember just thinking, like, that this was, like, a massive change, like, direction change. But that weird sort of thing where, like, I made friends with all these guys and all these girls for about 5-6 years, and then I was stepping into their world, so I felt like I have to be at least decent at this. I don't have to be good, but I at least need to show how dedicated and how much I love this. Because I didn't want to insult the people that I know had been working their backsides off to even build ICW to what it was at that time. Never mind what it is now. So yeah, it was more like I knew I had to show them that this wasn't just me thinking, I can do this. You know what I mean? Like, when people just sort of watch comedians and go, I can do that. Like, no, you can't. And it's the same sort of thing. Like, no, like, you can't just be a wrestler. you can't, no, you can be a wrestler, but you, to be a good one, to be somebody that's believable, to be someone that is, that has at least a future. Like, they weren't expecting me to come out and just instantly be a superstar, but at the same time, I wanted to make sure that they thought, she's competent enough for a future, and she's clearly not here to just play wrestler. She actually wants to do this. So yeah, it was like a lot of pressure, but at the same time, I had a nice, had a good environment around me who were behind me and had all the confidence in me. But at the same time, I knew I needed to at least do well. Doesn't have to be perfect. Nobody's first match is perfect. But at least well enough that people would say, you know what, she could do this.
And then from that point onwards, Chris did PWE. He did a bit with the team GPWA and team PWE. Was it all you guys kind of against each other, pretty much. And then you seem to have made a staple of yourself down south, down England. Was that a conscious decision? Because you kind of planted your roots in like Future Shock and TNT, as opposed to up here. Was there any further thought? Or was that just what happened?
It's a weird sort of thing where, obviously not at that point, I'd obviously wrestled up here for a few places. Predominantly was for sort of GPWA stuff. So I'd had matches, but it was weird. There was a point in time where I remember looking in my diary at the end of 1 year and realising that I'd wrestled every single weekend, but I hadn't wrestled in Scotland. And it was a weird sort of notion where I was like, I'm like, there was a place I remember I worked for a company called Tidal in Leeds, and them actively saying to me, yeah, no, but we booked you because you're known at Future Shock, like you're known in this area. And I was like, oh, okay, like it, because I worked in Manchester, I got a booking in Leeds. It wasn't because I was, you know what I mean? It was like, well, people are aware of your face. They've seen your face in this sort of in this section of the country. So yeah, that's why you got booked. And I was like, oh, okay, that's cool. But aye, there was a point where not even like working just down south, like I spent more time on aeroplanes than I did wrestling. Like going to other countries, never mind like wrestling in my own country. And it was a bit bizarre to see. But for me, it was that case of we had a seminar with Nigel McGuinness. Remember, he came in and had this seminar. And one of the things he said is that he wished, the one thing that he would change is that he would wish that he'd went and just got more matches under his belt rather than waiting and like trying to get that. And at that point, like with GPWA, because there's like, there's sort of like stepping stones, right, to the thing. So once you've done your training and stuff, and you're at a point where you're ready for a show, there's the £5 wrestling shows. So it's a fiver to get in. This is predominantly when like friends and family and stuff like that come to see what people have essentially been up to, right? They come and knows of what's this thing you keep leaving to go do for hours on end, and then why are you watching these tapes and stuff? So they come and watch. And then it goes up to Wrestling Experience Scotland, which is obviously the family-orientated shows, which happen in all different places. They were going to be in Glenrothes and Bathgate and stuff like that. It wasn't just in Glasgow, where you're from, kind of thing. And then, obviously, the next one up there is ICW, which is a whole different lion's den. Like, you've got to be able to impress to be in there, kind of thing. But yeah, it was that weird sort of notion, but instead of just, I'd done sort of at that point, it was before £5 wrestling was really a thing, but I'd done like the Asylum shows, I'd done that sort of thing. And then the opportunity came about for me to do a booking at Future Shock. And I'd known Chris Brooker, the guy that was running and booking the shows there for a while. I'd sort of helped a couple of tours of his, be it like with Rowdy Roy Piper or DDP. So I just being a helping hand because he was friends with Billy, and I thought, well, hi, I can help. I'm happy to direct people and stuff like that. And he'd started running Future Shock. And in all honesty, my first booking was probably because I was his friend. You know what I mean? But he knew that I was at a point where I was getting bookings. I was doing matches. I was capable enough to do a match, if that makes sense. Like, it was the early days of Molly Spartan being the wrestler, but I was more than capable. So I know, like, at that show, Wolfgang was booked as well, and we both sort of drove down. But at the same time, it was that weird notion going into it, thinking, I'm aware of Future Shock. Like, I'm from Kirkcaldy. I live in Glasgow. But I'm aware of Future Shock. I know the promotion Future Shock. I know who's come from Future Shock. And at that point in time, the roster had Zach Gibson, James Drake, Ashton Smith, T-Bone. They were sort of, that mainstay were all there performing regularly. And I was quite like, oh, this is like a, this is quite an interesting locker room. And of course, Lana Austin was there, who's just a mainstay in British wrestling, never mind female British wrestling, but in British wrestling. And that was who I was up against. So I knew that this was like a chance for me to sort of really learn and learn a different area altogether, a different locker room altogether, and sort of have a match with someone like Lana, and have those sorts of eyes around me to give me feedback. You know what I mean? Like a different sort of feedback kind of thing as well. But I also knew that if I maybe, if I really try, like if I kicked down the door and took the bull by the horns, that I might get asked back. And that was sort of my thinking going in. But to my surprise, a few months later, I was asked back and asked to stay for like roughly about a year plus. And at that point, it was me and Jayla Dark to start with. And then it moved into me, Jayla Dark, and Casey Owens joining. Surprise, surprise, I can't get rid of Casey Owens. She just seems to always be there. Yeah, it was interesting, like, so a totally different area, fully having confidence in you. Yeah, back home, it was just wasn't happening. And it wasn't that I wasn't talking to people and trying, it just wasn't happening. They would either have an idea of somebody from their school that they wanted to do, or they had this, that, and the next thing. It just wasn't really happening. But I didn't take a huff in that. I just went, okay, I understand. I'll go find someplace else that will have me, if that makes sense. Like, I'll wrestle everywhere and anywhere. I've wrestled in some of the best rings and some of the worst rings in the country and in the world, if I can say that. But I always just took it as everything, like, I'm just going to learn. And it was that sort of thing with Nigel McGuinness saying that he wished he sort of got out there and sort of got more matches under his belt when he knew he was ready for it. And because I'd done the Asylum shows and because of that, I knew I was ready to have more matches. I just wanted to wrestle as many people as I could that wasn't just from where I was in order to learn. Because really that's when you learn, when you step in with varieties of different... So I've had matches with people that speak not a word of English. I've had matches with people that speak too much. I've had, you know what I mean? But I've got this vast experience over a period of time because I didn't just go, I'm just going to wait until I get a booking here or a booking here. I'm going to sit in a car for 5-6 hours and go drive and do it in some working man's club in the middle of a housing estate and wherever. And I'm going to have a great time. I'm going to have fun doing it. And then I'm going to come back because it was all learning. It was all matches and it was like new matches that I can have. And if I had a screamer, I can maybe ask for a copy of it to then send to the next promoter and to send this. So it was very sort of proactive in that way where I will just sort of ask like, hi, can I send you matches for consideration in the future? And most people sort of go, yeah, here's an email address. All right, I'll send you this, this, and this, and I'll send stuff over to them. And 9 times out of 10, I get nothing back, but that one out of 10 is at least something. So, that's the only reason why I think I was in. But now I've done so much that I've worked for companies like ROH, and I've worked for, like, I've become like a mainstay in Liverpool now with TNT, with the She-Wolves, which again was another thing that I sort of approached with an idea and they listened, which was great. It's a great place to work because of that. But making myself a mainstay in Manchester for a long period of time, even holding their championship, which has such a long line of lineage, is like looking at them who's held it. It's just cool to be in that group of people. And then moving out to Liverpool and sort of still keeping a name there. And like, I wrestle in like Newcastle a lot and everybody's cool there. Like, they know who I am because I've been there already, kind of thing. And they see the development as well of who Molly Spartan is from the first time they've seen her to who she is now. But yeah, like, I've been to different countries. Like, the last country, like, I think my last match before lockdown was the Pavilion show in Glasgow. But I'd literally, like, a couple of days, but flew back in from Germany. And weirdly, again, I was wrestling Casey. I can't get rid of her, even when I go to Germany. But yeah, it's that kind of way where I think I've done so much now that you can't ignore me. If you know what I mean, like, you sort of need to acknowledge the fact, like, okay, right, yeah, we can't ignore her anymore. We need her now. And it's good, because it's only down the road. Like, I may have found my favourite McDonald's. It's at Johnston Bridge. It's an hour outside of Glasgow. It's an hour drive home before you get back home. But it's just over the border. It's not the Gretna one, but it's the one. Like, this is how much I know. I know, like, I'm getting chicken nuggets now. Like, that's how much I'm being at this one. And I'm like, hot chicken nuggets. I want fresh fries and fresh chicken nuggets after I've just wrestled and sat in a car for 3 hours to get here. Come on. None of your sitting ones sitting for a while. Fresh ones. Get the bad boys in. But yeah, that's sort of how that explains it. I kind of rambled a bit.
That's all right. I'm fairly certain you've seen my notes, because as you were going through, it was going, yep, TNT, yep, She-Wolves, yep, Grado's Family Bash, all these just getting ticked off and I haven't even asked them, so that's fine. So you mentioned Germany, but the one I was like, I didn't know about, which I'm disappointed as someone who's supposed to be all-knowing in the Scottish wrestling scene, is wrestling in Israel.
Yeah.
How's that?
It was great, like, the show was great. It was one of the best rings I've ever wrestled in, but I think it's because they hardly ever had it up. But yeah, there's like this company, IPWA, and they're one of like the only wrestling companies there. But no, like, this show was mad. Like, it was sort of that mad sort of thing where, so the poster was, there was one sort of local guy on the poster, there was me, and there was Billy Gunn, Darby Allin, Sammy Guevara, Matt Sydal, yeah, and me, and I was the female input, and I was like, how's this happened? What? And like, there was points where like I was trying to like stretch out and Sammy Guevara's going past with his like GoPro doing a vlog and he's like, sorry, and I'm like, it's alright, it's fine, like, but yeah, it was great. It was one of the first places that I've wrestled where, like, so when I was over there I had to switch my like roaming data on my phone or I would have had like a ridiculous phone bill. So the only time I ever had like internet was when I was in my hotel and I had Wi-Fi. But it was one of the first places where after the show, I was like inundated with messages of people just saying, thank you for coming. Like, thanks for coming. We really appreciate it. Like, not like people don't really come to wrestle here. And I was like, okay. And like, they were so nice and respectful. Like, when I landed, there was somebody there to pick me up. They took me to dinner. They got me my hotel. They drove me wherever I needed, and I was like, this is weird. And the icing on the cake, right, and I'll give you this, the icing on the cake was being able to, like, after the show, so the show was incredible, like, people were really responsive, their setup was like, it was in like a cinema. I've never been in a place like this before. It was like the place where if you walked around the building, there was all these like life-size mannequins of stuff. So like, you walked in and like one side had like the Imperial Army, so it was all stormtroopers, and another side was all the Power Rangers. And then you'd walk through, and then there was just like, it was mad. There was like a Woody and Buzz, and then there was all this stuff about it, and it was cool. But it was in like a cinema, so it was like tiered seating, and then there was a stage. But no, it was great. Everybody was nice. They had like lovely food and that put aside from us at the back. But it was afterwards going to dinner with Billy Gunn. So I went to dinner with Billy Gunn and these sort of two Israeli sort of born wrestlers, but who trained with Billy in America. And like that seemed to be a way that a lot of them sort of learned how to get better, was a couple of them would go away to like Billy Gunn or like maybe the 3D school or like Landstorm school, then come back to Tel Aviv and teach the others what they'd learn. And it was really interesting. And they had some really good talent that was over there. And the, like completely capable and had the whole gear and stuff. But then going to... So, have you ever seen the film Inglourious Basterds?
I have not, but I know enough of it. I know enough about it.
In this reference, right, okay, everybody else who's seen the film will understand this reference point. The best way I describe Billy Gunn is he... We walked into this restaurant, right? And what he did was, when Brad Pitt appears in the film and he's pretending to be the Italian director, right? That's Billy Gunn. Right? He walked into this restaurant and was like, buongiorno. And then I was like, what? And I just went, oh my God, you're Brad Pitt for that thing, Glorious Bastards. And I was like, this is great. And then there was another point where we were walking through the car park going to the car. And right, so this old woman drives up beside him. Why is she drove up to Billy Gunn? Because she's so clearly American, right? Drives up to him, rolls down his window and is shit, like asking him something in Hebrew. He's not got a clue what she's saying. And all he does is he keeps on saying, see, see, see. And I'm like, what is happening here, right? And she's getting more and more annoyed in this car. She's like, and starts shouting at him. Now, I look over at the two boys with Tel Aviv, and they are crying, right? They are crying of laughter. And I'm going, I don't understand what's happening here. It's not that funny, right? And then with the woman eventually just drives off in a rage. And he's like, well, what was wrong with her? And they went, in Hebrew, C pretty much translates into faster. So he's just been going, faster, 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 to this poor woman who's asking for directions. And he's just going, faster. And she's just going, ah. She's just going away, and I'm like, oh my God. But like, even like when I first got in the car, I hadn't like met him that morning. I got in the car, like we walked to the car, we hadn't really spoken. I like got in the car, I remember like opening my mouth for the first time, because I was thinking like, I'm not just going to sit in this car in silence. I'm going to talk. Like, I'm going to be part of this conversation, because they three knew each other and I was the new person. And I ended up speaking and he just went, where are you from? Because you've got a different voice to them, right? And I went, yeah, but mine's is a wee bit sexy. And he was just like, yeah! But it was that way when he was just great. But one of the major sort of things was, so a couple of years beforehand, Billy had come over and was doing PWE. And he did a training seminar at the school, and he was on me the entire time. He was shouting at me and just having a right go at me. And I remember the entire time, every time I'd get up, he'd shout at me and he'd have a go. And I remember thinking, F you, Billy Gunn, F you, right? Every time I got up, I was like, real, right? And then the thought of like being on a show with them like a couple of years later, I was like, yeah, I'm on the poster with you now, big boy, right? But when we went to dinner, he was talking about how he coaches and like his school and how there's certain people that he needs to basically like mollycoddle and like sort of make them feel sort of like a different approach. He can't shout at them. But then there's those that he knows he can shout at and like get them to go, like that's how you motivate them kind of thing. And I realised, oh, that's what he was doing. He was doing it because he wasn't just having a go. That's just how he coaches. And I realised that. So I decided, to tell him that for nearly a year, I told him this, like, you came and did this and blah, 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 and you were on me the entire time. I was like, and for about a year solid, every time I got off that mat, I thought, F you, my God. And he just laughed. He was like, that's great, that's great. And I was like, yeah. He just laughed. I was like, honestly, for about a year, I've just cursed you out. Every time I've got off the right aftermat, I've just been like, see me now. And now I'm like, I'm not on the show. He was like, that's great. So he was great. So it was that weird sort of like full circle of me just being like, you're really good. So like, hey, by the way, I've cussed you out for like a year and a bit. But yeah, that was great. But like, yeah, being like, not only going to Tel Aviv, being in a place that's just was just so like different, but also like so welcoming and so respectful, and then yeah, being able to sort of be on that show with talent that way as well, because like AEW just really started and we're like properly trying to find our feet, and yeah, it was cool. It was cool. And yeah, like, yeah, like I'd go back, you know what I mean? Because they were such a welcoming crowd and place.
So you had that feeling, like seeing all these people going, oh my God, I'm in a locker room with them. Did you have that kind of same feeling for Ring of Honor as well when they were doing their Honor United tour?
It was cool. Like it was the nice thing about it was there were faces that were familiar in the ROH locker room. So you had Rampage Brown was on it. And obviously the Haskins were there and I knew them from TNT and stuff. So like having faces that I was like, you know, I'm okay. Like, you know, I'm a decent person. Like, you're my vouch. You know what I mean? Like, you're the people that will be like, she's cool. Don't worry about it. But it was that way where, yeah, it was cool. Just sort of like the people that I've sat and watched on YouTube and watched on like my fight app and everything like that. We're in this, and like there was loads of times where like I'd be watching like Peacock World, like, and then all of a sudden I was booked in that show. It was bizarre. I'll be honest, when I got the first message from them saying like, can you send me like all your details, I threw it across my phone across the living room and like just threw it in the couch and was like, ah. And I remember Wolfie going, what's wrong? Like, and I was like, I think ROH wants to book me. And they were like, what? And I was like, I think ROH is trying to book me. I don't know how this has happened. Like, but like, yeah, it was all, and it's a funny story, and Casey loves this story, right? She thinks it's, she, the amount of times she's like, tell that one. But when I was there, so I'd been chatting with them, but it hadn't all been confirmed, but like, it was the Tuesday where it was fully like, it's confirmed, like, it's you definitely kind of thing. Here's your graphics, this is what's going to go out, and like when the graphic was going to go out and when the announcement was going to be made, came through on the Tuesday, and I was at training that night. Like I was in the asylum training, and it was that weird moment where I was like between friends and we were doing like our roles and I'm going, are you okay? And I'm going, I'm booked for ROH on Sunday. And I'm going, what? And I go, I'm on the ROH show. And they're like, that's great. And I was like, what? This is mad. But then there was this moment. So the Sunday before that Tuesday, I was in London, and I wrestled Vader Scott, right? We had this great match, and I wrestled Vader Scott. And then the Tuesday, booked, confirmed of it, was in the school. But in the school, I had this sort of idea for something that I wanted to sort of introduced to my repertoire, or like how to get into like getting reverse it and things like that, and I sort of had it in my head I wanted to finalize, so I sort of finalized it on that Tuesday night of like, this is how I go about doing this. And I remember on the show Speedball Mike Bailey was booked on the ROH show, so Vader showed up with him and it was great to see her. I was like, hi, how are you doing, etc. And then after the show had finished and I was packed up and we were all sorted, Mike came up to me and went, can I ask you something? And I was like, yeah, like, was everything okay? Like, what's up? He was like, see that sit out thing you did? I went, yeah. And he went, why did you not put in that in your match with Vader? And I was like, I had to go, do you want to know the truth? He was like, yeah. I was like, I figured it out on Tuesday. I was like, so I couldn't have put it in the match on Sunday because I'm not a Time Lord. And he was like, ah, yeah, you should do that more. I was like, thanks. Like, it was like a compliment, but it was that weird sort of moment. I was like, why did you not do that? What? Wait, there was plenty of times you could have done that. What? And I was like, that was Sunday. I figured it was on Tuesday. So yeah, but like, it was great. And everybody there was really welcoming and really polite. And like, yeah, like, I would love to do more work with them in the future. And like, working with Mandy was great. And yeah, we'd love to do more work with them in the future. But of course, the world went on fire not long after that. So it kind of put a wee bit of a pause on things.
Again, master the segue I've got you here. But the one note I've got here is, yeah, you're on the last show before the world ended. Was there any tension? Because it was literally the last show with the crowd in Scotland anyway. Was there a bit of a, oh, they shaking hands at the show? Was there any underlying, like,
what, like the Pavilion show?
Yeah.
It was very different. Like, yeah, there was an air of, like, things, we knew things weren't going to be like this for a while. So it was enjoyable, but there was like an element of sadness to it as well, because we knew things were dramatically going to change. It wasn't just going to be the way it's been in the past. But yeah, like, everybody kind of had their own sort of dressing room area, but it was the closest thing to what could have been normal, but still, there was anti-back everywhere, and like, you weren't allowed to hang around in like the area, like sort of the area before you went out, like before like your entrance kind of thing. Everybody was sort of in their own wee bit. But no, like, it was a lovely area, like, it was a lovely show, and it was nice. And I think people appreciate the fact that they were getting this one last hurrah before they knew they weren't going to get it for a while. But yeah, because I think like that happened on like the Saturday or the Sunday, and like Monday lockdown started, it was like the last thing that we could do. But yeah, it was great to do it, and I was delighted to be asked to be on it. And then obviously it was that weird sort of like happy but sad kind of mix of things, knowing that, okay, like, this isn't going to happen like this for a while. And of course it hasn't.
And of course you've been on the ICW network, on the WWE network now, with no crowd. And this is just, it seems to be the worst timing, because you were just starting to like get a footing in ICW, and that was going to be where you were going to maybe primarily be, because it's up the road. And then of course the world ended, and then you haven't been able to. But what's it been like wrestling in the asylum with no crowd?
That's the thing. Like, a lot of people have asked sort of like, is it, but you say the worst timing, where in actual fact, I see it as a prime opportunity. Because let's be honest, right now we're in a blip in time, we're in a blip in history, that when we're all dead and gone, people are still going to talk about this time in history. We're going to talk about the time where the first ever British WWE champion was crowned when there was no crowd, and it's a historic time. But the thing is, we also know that once we do get out the other end of this, there's a new normal going to be there. It's not going to be the same, and it's not going to be like that ever again. We just need to get to grips with that. It's not going to be like that ever again. We're all going to be more aware of things, and maybe like the culture like Japan has, where you wear a mask when you're ill in order to prevent people getting, like, hopefully things like that sort of come over and that becomes the new normal. So for me, I see that as a prime opportunity to change things. And in order to do so, I always had that in my mind. Like, the first ever proper debut I had for ICW was the last ICW show that also had a crowd. And weirdly, again, was against Casey. But it's that way where, on that show as well, the women's title was vacated because Evo was injured and couldn't continue as the champion at that time. So there's this big vacant, and that's what it is, it's a big vacant gap that is in the women's division in ICW. And you know what, there might not be a crowd around the ring, but there's a crowd sitting at home. There's a crowd now sitting on their couches. So you need to direct everything to the one giant eyeball that's in the room, which is in that camera lens. It's no longer small eyeballs that are watching you and in a room full of people. They're all just condensed into one giant one now. So for me, this is the start of change, and it's absolutely nothing towards previous performers. Of course it's not. Like, the likes of Piper Niven or Viper, however you know her, or Kaylee Ray or Carmel Jacobs, or even Casey Owens, who previously held the title, are all respectable and hardworking and have gone to where they are now because they deserve to be there. But the thing is I feel that company has left the title vacant when I actually feel like it's not necessary. Like, on Bard, the question I'm going to constantly ask, and I'm going to ask until maybe somebody eventually gives me an answer, but I doubt they ever will. But I kind of know the answer is, why on earth is that women's championship not on the line in the cage match? Is it because secretly you know the outcome? Is it because secretly you know that really I'm the inevitable? I'm the person that was overlooked for years because I already had a job. I had a role. But that's not the case anymore. I've went and I've travelled the world and I've grafted to a point where you couldn't deny me anymore. You couldn't overlook me anymore because the rest of the world wasn't. And you'd look like a fool if you did when the person that you need in your promotion is sitting down the road. So for me, this is the prime opportunity, especially now, with Bard being broadcast on Peacock, not just on the WWE Network in the UK, on Peacock, which is in 34 million people's houses in America. It's one of the biggest streaming services in America, where, let's be honest, that's kind of the Mac Daddy of professional wrestling is America. Japan is completely revered, and it's beloved, and it's a place I would wholeheartedly love to go and wrestle and train in because of how respected it is. But if you want to get to, like, superstardom, you either need to be Okada in Japan, and that's tough, or America's really where it goes. So if you're able to make a statement and make a change, why not do it now when it's not just the 1,000-odd people who surround the ring, it's the millions who are sitting at home and we're what they have to watch.
Yeah, I don't think there's anything I can really add or put to that, because that was just, you've, again, I'm finding with yourself, you've made so many steps to grab any puzzle piece to add to your, so you've done the work experience for wrestling, you've studied to be a wrestler, you've taken advices, we've said go abroad, go, or Nigel Guinness was like, he wanted to I was going to say sow your seeds, but you know what I mean.
Broaden
your horizons, there we go.
And you were looking for it.
That was the one. And you've done that, and now that you're getting a chance to actually prove yourself in your home Scotland, yeah, country. Yeah. So I'm all flustered because that was so intense. So I'm just like, how did I recover from this?
It's not just me. There are others who are thinking the same way. It's just, it will all unfold because we're again we're not just going into what was in the past. There is going to be change. There's going to be an order put in place. And yeah, it's going to be interesting. And if I have anything to do with it, it's going to be unmissable to watch, because you're going to want to know what on earth is going to happen next.
And that's the best thing about wrestling. That's when wrestling's at its best. It's that. You just want to know what happens and want more. Right. So we'll take down the intensity for a minute and ask some of our stupid questions. And then we'll just to kind of just breathe. Jason Hyde asked, largest animal you could beat in a fight?
A wolf gang.
Nice. That's a good one.
No, I'm not saying that. I'm just going, oh, no. It depends, right? That I think I've seen that question, and I actually started thinking about it. Like, it depends on the approach. Are they just attacking me and I'm having to defend myself like that? Or am I getting to, like, prepare? Because if I'm getting to prepare, I'm taking anything down. Like, I'll figure it out. I'm that kind of person that goes, right, what have I got? How can I do this? How can I make this work? I'm that kind of person. So, like, actively, Wolfie has said that, like, if we both got stranded someplace, I'm the one keeping us alive. Like, I'm the one that'll figure out, how do I catch this? How do I get that? But if it's, like, straight up having a fight, I'm not sure. I'll punch a llama if it comes at me. I'm not sure. I think I could have a square go with quite a lot of stuff, but if I get a chance to prep. But if it's a straight-on attack, oh, I don't know. I don't know.
I mean, Jason's question didn't necessarily say what would you... Did it say what would you beat in a fight, or just what would you fight? And, oh, yeah, you could beat, I suppose. I thought it was just like...
I guess it depends on the approach. Like, if I'm allowed to prepare for the fight, look, I'm taking anything down. Like, I'll beat it off, like, because I'll figure out how to do it. But if it's just, right, I'm coming to get you, you need to defend yourself. Oh, it depends. It depends on how cunning they are compared to me. Like, I think I'd have a fair go at most things. I'm not going to just roll over. Like, that's fair to say that. Like, I might end up mauled to death, but the thing's going to cut. I'm going to have, like, chunks of hair in my hands. Like, you're going to think, oh, well, she tried. She had a fair go.
I've got a feeling that's going to be one of the questions that later you're just going to be sleeping and just go, dog. Probably take a dog.
Dog? No! But then again, what kind of dog?
Exactly.
Are we talking a Great Dane?
Yeah, this is one that's just going to keep you up all night. The other questions I have is, what's your favourite dinosaur?
Triceratops.
See, that's a popular one. I thought you would have went for Rex.
See, Rex is, but... So for me, it's more like Land Before Time, and Matilda from Robot Wars was shaped like a triceratops. So I'd say that Alex Salmon is a bit spiky, because I'm also like a mad metalhead too. So I like a spike. I like a wee. So that makes sense.
Yeah, I'm Trixie, of course, as well in Toy Story.
Yeah.
And the other one we've got is, what would win in a fight, two sheep or one cow?
Is it a Highland cow?
I will leave that up to your own interpretation.
If it's a healing cow, the healing cow's winning. But I think a cow. I'll give the cow the benefit of the doubt. I think a sheep would... I'll pick it, like, although a cow running is one of the funniest things, it's still pretty scary. If a sheep runs at me, I'm not that scared. And usually it puffs up and goes to sleep. I'm getting into the coup. The coup's getting it.
I mean, I always say these are the stupidest questions, but it always seems to be the ones that folk just have to think about the most. Because when you do a wrestling interview, you kind of know what you're going to be asked. And you've done enough interviews now that you kind of know what's going to be asked, but then I just come around with, oh, we're in a fight, too stupid a cow.
I used to do a podcast for like music festivals and stuff, like back when I was a teenager. And we used to do the same. We would have an ending question, and every month had like the one daft question. And my favourite one that I did, it was a festival called Hinterland, which was around Glasgow, and it was loads of music venues, was in a fight to the death, who wins, Chuck Norris or John McClane? And like I had bands fighting, like straight up arguments of like, no. But, and like, my best answer was for a band, the Aberdeen, called The Excerpts, and their answer was, how dirty is John McClane's vest? Because if it's really dirty, he's winning. But if it's new John McClane vest, then nah, Chuck's winning this. And I was like, okay. Like, it was the way they just thought about it, and they were like, how dirty is John McClane's vest? And I was like, that's the kind of answer I want. Like, I'm thinking about this. But yeah, that was like a question we did. But I always remember that one being my favourite of mine, because like full-grown men having proper arguments going, no, it'd be Chuck. No, John would. That's like, cool.
I'm going to go with, again, how much preparation. If you get preparation, it's John McClane. Easy.
You're saying that, but Texas Ranger, if he had preparation, it could be Chuck.
I'm too young to have seen Texas Ranger, so I'm gonna.
No, I know too, but like watching in the past is like it's more like the idea of like dodgeball of like thank you Chuck Norris, like you're like yeah okay, and like well, a lot of people would argue that like Chuck Norris is real and John McClane's fictional. There was loads, but like proper as I'm saying, like proper arguments start it, and then be like. But yeah, but what John McClane? Is it like first John McClane, second John McClane? What Chuck Norris? And I'd be like, it's just Chuck Norris and John McClane. But yeah, that was a thing that it started at like a party I was at. It was like a daft question somebody asked when they were steaming, like who'd win? And I was like, I'm using that. And then it became a thing and it was great.
That's it. That's how I've picked up these questions. It was Luke King, Sharp and Krieger that seemed to argue about the two sheep and one cow. I thought, I'm keeping that one. I will be using it in future episodes. Thank you. Right. So I know I've kept you for just about 2 hours. So I will ask a couple more things. I'll do social medias then. We can all have this is Friday night for anyone who's on the Patreon. They'll see it early. They'll know that I'm recording this on Friday. You quite like toys. You quite like collectibles, toys, things like that. We were talking about it before we hit record. You say you've got a ridiculous collection. What would be your favourite?
Oh, Jesus Christ. It depends. Like, our collections of stuff are ridiculous. Like, we have... Our kitchen wall is pretty much consumed with pin badges. Our living room is pretty much consumed with pop figures. It depends. Like, there's daft ones where I absolutely love my, like, coming to America and, like, my trading placey, sort of that comedy aspect of, like, stuff that I love. And obviously there's the massive wrestling collection we have. And, like... I love my Rowdy Piper. I love my CM Punk one. But I really love, and this one, I've got a really mad soft spot for Kane. And like the Kane Funko Pop is adorable. Like, it's so damn cute. It's like, it's great. But I've been lucky enough to do like tours with Undertaker and Mick Foley and Shawn Michaels and Bret Hart, so I've been able to get all those Funko Pops signed, and like they're on like a special sale. So I've got a bunch of stuff that really sign up, but then I've got weird things like I bought a nun doll from Nun Valley in Madeira off a nun, and it is so creepy. It like has like rolling eyes and everything. It's so creepy that I adore it. Like, adore it because of how creepy. And then I got a soft toy Cardinal Copy for Ghost that sits beside it now. So he's got his nun with the Cardinal, with his sister. I've got loads. I've got absolutely loads of stuff, but things that, like, either I was as a kid or, yeah, I've got Hannah's. They all mean, like, mad. Some, like, figures, like, to other people are completely worthless but mean everything to me. Like, I love, like, when I watch, started watching ECW, like, Joey Styles, I just, oh my god! Like, all this, and, like, realising, like, how many pay-per-views he did by himself, and we found a Joey Styles figure in Australia, and I was like, I'm buying this, and they were like, it's like, and I was like, this is mine. I think my favourite wrestling figure I have is a Steve Corino one I've got, and it's the only Steve Corino wrestling figure that has ever been produced, because I freaking love Steve Corino. Like, I adore him. I think he was CM Punk before CM Punk was CM Punk. He's just great. I love him to bits. And yeah, like, Wolfie found a mint condition, like, in its packaging, CM Punk, whatever to say, Steve Corino figure. And I adore that. That's, like, my favourite wrestling figure. But I've got loads. Like, I've got, like, mint condition, like, JLN, like, Who Framed Roger Rabbit figures from, like, the late 80s and 90s. I've got, yeah, like, my collection is a bit, our collection's a bit silly, but it's very us. Like, it's incredibly us. But yeah, like, being able to get, like, my age figures, like, that I had through here that were in packaging signed and stuff. So I've got loads of weird things that I love and are very, most of our toys, particular our figures, like, are very sentimental, and, like, we buy things that we like. It's not necessarily, like, complete collections, but a lot of it is because we love that film so much, or we love, like, the only part that I'm missing is of Randy Watson from Coming to America, and it is genuinely, I've got some pop figures that are stupidly priced now, like, how much you've got, and I'd happily hand it over for a Randy Watson. Be like, here you go, give me that, because it's more to do with the sentimental side of things than just that'll be worth something in the future. Like, no, like, it could become, like, there's a couple of ones that I've got that I bought for a fiver and now have 10 times the value, if not plus more on some of them, but yeah, I'm not going to show you, but yeah, our house is a bit silly. It's exactly what we'd want it to be.
I know, I've never been so gutted, because I kind of had a couple pops and thought, ah, these are just little things, I'm not going to collect them. I've never been so gutted to not pick up a Roddy Piper when they first came out, because finding one now is like gold dust. If you do find it, it's like a ridiculous price. I was like, I want it. Not that much, but I want it. But I made sure, as soon as Drew was up for pre-order, I was like, nope, that's getting ordered now. I'll have that one, please.
They're pretty much the Edge pop, the China pop, and the Drew pop. And I was like, one of the women's I had, like, I love China. Like, I've got books and videotapes and all weird stuff. China, love her. But then, like, Drew and Edge, and I was like, they were my Rumble picks. But yeah, like, somebody who I call a friend, and Edge, who weirdly will talk to me when I talk to him back. You seen that coming?
I have that exact same relationship with Drew, the second one with you and Edge, because I somehow he follows me on my personal page on Twitter. I have no idea why. Still don't know why. But I messaged him after he won at WrestleMania, and I was just like, thank you, and well done, all that. And he replied back. I'm like, why are you replying?
He's so, like, Drew is one of the most hardworking, driven, focused men I've ever met in my life, but is an absolute gem. Like, he deserves everything he's got. everything that he's worked for. Like, I actually talk about, Drew taught me how to clothesline, because I asked him a question, he then clotheslined me 3 times, and I got it. Like, I was like, okay, yep, I get this now. Like, I just remember, he said to me, just went, okay, bang, get up, you get it now? And I was like, yep, I get it now, okay. But yeah, he completely deserves everything he's got. And I love the fact that his wee smirk is on the pop figure. The wee, like, I remember the amount of times where, like, for some reason, I always remember the square go where, obviously, like, you do, like, the halftime main event kind of thing, and then it's the square goes the second half. And he was the champ at the time. And, like, by the end of the show, he still hadn't got out his gear. The whole square go had happened, and he was still talking to folk just in his gear. And I remember he came out to see somebody, and everybody's like, clear, like, there's people sweeping the floor for all the pint tumblers, and me having to shout at Drew, like, Drew, get clothes on! And he's like, sorry. Like, he's just one of those guys who's just like, we all love you, and we're all delighted that you've got to where you are. Like, because you're good people. Like, that's the best about it. You're so driven, you're so hardworking, but you're also, you've got a vision that you want to bring everybody up with you. It's not just about, he understands it's not just about you. It's about everybody. And if he can bring a product up or things like, he carried, like, think of it, he was the champ through all of this pandemic. And he took it in his stride. He didn't moan once. He didn't complain. He just did his job, and he made people actually still, like, the boy's a champ. With a title or not, he's still a champ. And he's ours.
He's ours. Right, so one more, and then we'll do the social media. You recently announced you were going to be in a book. Independent Road. Oh, I did my research. Independent Road by Erin Shafir? I don't know. Sorry, Erin. I don't know how to say your surname. But yeah, what was that like? Again, to provide some of your story or a bit of your insight.
It was cool. Like, it was okay, genuinely, at first I thought it was a wind-up. I was like, you want me for your book? Like, I'm going to be honest, when I put out the bat signal for the podcast, a lot of genuine podcasts came forward. And I also got a couple of people going, I'm thinking about trailing a podcast. And I was like, no, that's just, you just want me to phone you. Like, that's not happening. Like, no. like, not to be rude, but I was like, no. Like, trailing a podcast is when you do it by yourself and you chat about Raw. I'm no phoning you. Sorry. But I genuinely was about it, and then, like, no, like, he sort of showed me stuff that he wanted to write about, and we sort of had this conversation through Twitter, and then just had a chat with him, and, no, he was lovely, and he was telling me about the people that he also had on, and he had, like, Effie, and, like, Neon Ninja, and, like, why has her name escaped me? Mephisto, that was it. I could see it in my head, and I'm going, you know when sometimes you forget how to say mum, even though it's your mum? I had that kind of moment there. Mephisto was in it, and there was all these great names that I was like, I know them. Like, they're good. So yeah, and it was also like really cool being like the only like outside the States person. Like, I was sort of given the aspect of somebody who was British but Scottish and female. And yeah, I mean, it's been great. It's been doing incredible. And like, so it was released in Barnes & Noble, which is essentially like Waterstones in America kind of thing. And it's like, it's been at like 3 and 2. Like, it's been in the actual like top 10 for a while. And like, there was a point where he had great honour to like message me and just be like, by the way, the book's actually beating Drew's pre-orders for his book. And I was like, ah! But no, it's done really well. And it's sort of interesting, like, every day sort of getting a new follower and then realising, like, oh, you've read the book and that's how you've sort of come across me. I think now he's going on to write, he's planning on writing a full book on just female wrestlers and their journey, because I think he's realises that they can be very different roads and so very different approaches depending on where you've been trained, and because women are treated differently, like, and it's something that is changing, and it is, but it has been a thing, and it, obviously, like, I kept sort of stressing that I think now is a time where, although it is viewed very differently, there is a lot more respect and a lot more sort of eyes upon the product. I used to talk about how, like, I remember being in a pub once and the women's match came on at WrestleMania and actively seeing so many people just getting up and going to the bathroom. Like, watching an entire pub just go, right, okay, like, and being like, where are they going? And realising, oh, it's because of the women's matches on. And, like, at the time, didn't really take it in because I wasn't a performer then, but still thinking, like, that's a bit disrespectful. Like, if you're going to watch that, you could, like, but now really sort of being like, right, no. And obviously there has been a massive shift on the outlook of female wrestlers. But at the end of the day, although, of course, that's not my viewpoint, I also understand that there's going to be people who hate the fact that I even wrestle because I'm female. And although it's not the grand scheme now, people, those people are still going to exist. So for me, I feel like we can't get complacent in what we're doing. We always constantly have to strive to be better, to provide graft twice as hard as any guy can, because simply because of what's between our legs, which is sad at the end of the, it is sad that that is a thing, but it's what something we need to live with, and we need to constantly strive to be better and to constantly to be seen as equal performers. For me, there's a lot of times where people have asked me and my thoughts of, like, intergender wrestling, and it's something that I would apply to any wrestling, where if it makes sense, then why can't it be? Like, I'm not going to put, like, Alexa Bliss in the ring with Braun Strowman, because that doesn't make, you know what I mean? Like, I'm thinking size-wise, it makes sense. But if you put Seth Rollins in the ring with Charlotte Flair, physically there's not much difference there. They're both sort of, like, their background, their championships, their reigns, their everything is very kind of similar. There's that sort of thing where if it makes a lot of sense, like, you know, like Raquel Gonzalez probably overshadow a bunch of the guys and how physical and domination, and it's the same sort of idea as, like, what China was, but now there's more girls coming through like that, where if it makes sense, I have no issue with it, but I also know there's going to be a lot of people that do. But we need to take it upon ourselves, although a lot of people say, no, you don't, but we do have to take it upon ourselves to make sure that the opinion of female wrestling only gets better. And there's going to be people that constantly try and tear us down and constantly try and disagree the fact that we're even crossing between the ropes. But we need to be the ones that go, you're wrong and this is why. And just show them in the ring, this is why you're wrong. Because see all those people? They're watching us because we put on good performances. It's got nothing to do with our gender. You've got the problem. You need to get over it.
I think that's the perfect way to finish up then. A nice inspiration for anyone who's listening, male or female, pretty much. If you want to change the opinion, you got to work. And that's just how it's going to be. But yeah, where can people find you on social media?
I'm quite lucky in the fact that Molly Spartan is quite easy to find. If you Google Molly Spartan, everything pretty much comes up. So I'm Molly Spartan on Twitter, I'm Molly Spartan on Instagram, I'm Molly Spartan on TikTok. I think I'm Real Molly Spartan on Facebook, because there's also a roller derby player in America who took Molly Spartan. And then when she discovered that I existed, messaged me going, I keep getting really strange questions about wrestling and it now makes sense. And I go, yep, Okay, sorry. But yeah, if you end up putting in, you'll find pretty much everything. But yeah, that's where you can find me. And obviously, there is my other tag partner, Casey Owens, as well, with the She-Wolves, so you can find her. And obviously, we've got like our big cartel pages and stuff like that. So any support is welcomed, especially in the current climate. But if you can watch ICW Fight Club on the WWE Network, which I'm guessing a lot of people who are listening to this already have, each week, you're probably going to see me being a horrid human being, but I'm doing it for the best intentions.
Perfect. Well, thank you very much.